happy holidays, everybody. Kai Waza with you, John Charles. Welcome back to my channel. Having a little Christmas coffee with a little bit of Fireball in it. In my hoodie. It's a rainy, chilly day here in Honolulu. We've been having some, well, for us, it's kind of chilly weather. And I got to do some grocery shopping after this, so I'm ready to weather the elements. Anyway, we're here for Cheap Lounge. It is season 3 of Cheap Lounge. We're up to episode 13. I know it just seems like it's taking a lot longer to get through season 3 than the other two seasons, but I think I'm uploading so much music that I'm not, you know, talking about as much of it, so the Cheap Lounge episodes are further in few between. We got to work on that. Anyway, it's the Cheap Lounge. It's happy hour. Go get yourself a libation. A happy hour special. Come sit down with me, your cheap date, at the Cheap Lounge while we discuss cheap records. These are all inexpensive thrift store, dollar store records that I have uploaded onto Moody Mood Music, my online easy listening hobby radio station. That's linked below. You can check that out anytime you feel like it. Welcome. Episode 13. Let's talk first about this record right here, 5002 Pipes. This is on GNP Crescendo Records. It's from 1962, featuring two organs here. That's why I picked it up. I'm not necessarily super excited about organ records all the time, but this one, when I saw it, I'm like, oh, 5002 pipes, two organs playing. Is it different than one organ playing? I don't know. Let's find out. And it is actually by two artists, Alex Lasker, and the artist that I want to discuss a little bit that I'm interested in, Ivan Ditmar. Who is Ivan Ditmar? Ivan Ditmar is a composer, musical director, organist on actually hundreds of radio broadcasts from the radio times. He was born in 1907 in Olympia, Washington. Before he went away to college, went away to school, he was playing the organ and the piano at silent movies in various theaters, but hadn't really been trained. He then went to Boston musical training, eventually just returned to Los Angeles from the 1930s on, was basically in LA and was working. Although, if you look up Ivan Ditmar, and by the way, there are some variations of his name. Sometimes it's Ivan Ditmars with an S, sometimes it's Ivan Ditmar with two T's or one T. Shows up different ways. What I found interesting, now the reason I knew this name and I was familiar with the name Ivan Ditmar, like, curious, because Ivan Ditmar is one of the artists that is listed on the budget label's many Christmas records, where they would take various studio recordings and reissue them under many different artists' made-up names and chop them up and put them all on different combinations of different Christmas albums that they would just put out every year that were sold in grocery stores and whatnot for cheap. Ivan Ditmar is listed on some of those records as the organist for one of the two or three sets of organ, purely organ Christmas music they put out. Now, I guess, and those same tracks were also released under other names like William Daly and yada yada and anonymously as Organ and Chimes. So I guess the reason I was curious about this album is I wondered, is that actually the same Ivan Ditmar, or are the budget label Ivan Ditmar Organ Records actually recorded by Ivan Ditmar, or did they just use his name? I mean, it's not like he was some huge celebrity. I don't know. Or they were recorded by him and then licensed to these companies and they released it under other names too. I don't know, I'm just curious. I don't know, I wasn't able to find out the answer except that, you know, his budget label Christmas organ recording is listed in Discogs under Ivan Ditmar, but that doesn't necessarily mean anything. Really, it doesn't. I don't know. So I don't have the answer to that, but I was curious about it. He passed away, by the way, I don't think I mentioned, born in 1907, passed away in 1997 at the age of 90, lived quite a nice long life. Question then remains, do two organs sound different than one organ? And my answer is, I can't tell. I don't think so. Secondly, today, we have an artist that I mistakenly, apparently, never thought of as a singer. I just didn't think of this person was a singer. I knew the name from his television show, which ran for many, many years. He had a daytime talk show that was on network television from, well, started in 1961, but it was on network television from 1965 to 1980 or 81, I believe. 81, 20 years he had a talk show. And I'm talking about Mike Douglas. And then several years ago, I came across in the budget section, dollar bin, whatever, a Christmas record by Mike Douglas. And I thought, how curious. And of course, I, you know, digitized that and played that. And it's quite good. Like, oh, he's really quite a good singer. I just never knew that about him. Well, it turns out, you know, I'm the dummy here because apparently he sang a song at the beginning of every single show that he did. He had a daytime afternoon talk show and where a lot of people would open with monologues or comedy routines or whatever. He opened singing a song every week. I guess my parents never watched Mike Douglas. I didn't grow up watching him, so I didn't know. I knew who he was visually, you know, but I never watched his show, so I didn't know. He was born in 1920 in Chicago, passed away in 2006. The Mike Douglas Show began in 1960 in Cleveland. It went national in 1965, where they held it in Philadelphia, Pennsylvania, for 20 years. So, Michael Douglas is a good singer. That's what I've learned.
Books for me. Kenny, Daddy, is it all right, Dad? He's got freckles, Dad.
The man in my little girl's life. The man in my little girl's life.
Okay, you made my life complete. V means you're very sweet. W, X, Y, Z. It's fun to wander through the alphabet with you to tell you what you mean to me.
You have to laugh, though, because the men in my little girl's life is definitely not a song that would be recorded for various reasons in the 21st century. The implications of it. It's a very cute song in actuality. He's talking about his daughter and how there's a little boy that wants to play, and then there's a little boy that wants to, I don't know, go to the candy store or something with her, and then there's a boy that wants to take her to the prom, and then there's a boy that wants to, you know, she's getting older, take her out on go steady or go out on dates, and then there's a boy that wants to marry her, and then there's a new boy eventually in her life, which is her son. It's a very cute song, but all the songs on the album are about being young. Being a young person and certain things, or the passing of time. So, nice album. I enjoyed it, and he has a great voice. Next up is an artist I've been passing up at the thrift stores and dollar bins for decades. I mean, like, I just kind of see him and go, oh, no, not my thing. and just bypass it. And I have seen plenty of his records. I did get some time ago a Christmas album again by him called Christmas Candy. And I really liked it, and I was surprised. I wasn't expecting to like it. So it opened my eyes a little bit, and I still have kind of passed him up, because to be honest, he's an artist I thought was like purely Dixieland, and Dixieland's not really my thing. I'm talking about Pete Fountain, who is a clarinetist, who is generally, you know, I associated with Dixieland, although that turns out to not really be true. Again, incorrect on my part. This whole thing of collecting these easy listening albums and having this easy listening station, as much as I love the format and love the music, is also educational for me too. I mean, it's things I'm learning along the way for sure. Although I am familiar with some artists, other artists like this one, I didn't know that well. And apparently I was wrong in what I thought. I just think of him as being a Dixieland artist, but not really. I mean, he apparently, some of his records, some of them are somewhat traditional Dixieland, but really a lot of them are pop music. They're just instrumental pop music on the clarinet with like a tinge of a Dixieland feel to them, but very modern for the time, 1960s, we're talking, contemporary sort of pop music. Touch of Dixieland on the clarinet. So I did pick up this record, and I was so pleasantly surprised. And even it looks completely like it's going to be a new Dixieland record. It's called Pete Fountain, Dr. Fountain's Magical Licorice Stick Remedy for the Blues. I really encourage you to, when I show the back cover, to stop the video and read the liner notes, because they are really funny, and it's totally a takeoff on these old medicine men, you know, that would stand up and like be trying to sell you some remedy that cured everything. In reality, it was just like, you know, probably liquor mostly and castor oil or something, and it was supposed to cure everything in the world. But it's kind of a takeoff on that. Song titles. Some of them are originals. The title song, Licorice Stick Rag, Sulfur and Molasses, Hey Mr. Sun, Passport to the Future. Tell you a little bit about Pete Fountain. Kind of interesting. He did play the clarinet. He played from childhood, and actually he was quite ill as a child. He had a very weak lung. He had some lung infections. As a child, the doctor that his father took him to actually said, you know, it would be really good for him if you get some kind of musical instrument, any kind of musical instrument that you have to blow into, because that will help to strengthen his lungs somewhat or his capacity. So the father went out and they did get a clarinet. He wanted to get a drum, Pete Fountain, but that wasn't going to help. So they did get clarinet. He did learn. He did take lessons. He was always kind of had a bad lung his entire life. But this did help him, you know, get through all of that and function. And he did learn how to play it really well. When he was in high school, his grades were kind of, you know, and his teacher approached him and said, well, you know, why don't you study more? And he says, because I'm playing at night in clubs in New Orleans. I lived in New Orleans. And he was getting gigs at night. And he was making, at the time, just part-time, $125 a week, which was pretty substantial. And when his teacher learned that, his teacher said, well, you make more than I do. You should just quit and go full-time. Which I guess he did. So there you go. But he played briefly with Dukes of Dixieland. He had a band with Al Hurt, another well-known name, for a while. He was actually on the Lawrence Welk show for a while. Rumor is, a couple different stories, rumor is he actually walked off the Lawrence Welk show, though, because they wouldn't let him, Lawrence Welk wouldn't let him jazz up a Christmas song that he wanted to play. So he walked off. It was, even though he walked off, it was amicable in a way. He just said, is known as saying, well, ultimately bourbon and champagne don't mix, which is cute. Bourbon, New Orleans, and champagne music was Lawrence Welk. But he did actually, for the record, appear on several reunion shows with the Lawrence Welk cast. So they did part eventually. They were, you know, friendly or whatever. It wasn't a lifelong thing. He recorded over 100 records and CDs, so there's quite a lot out there. And there's plenty of Pete Fountain in the bargain bins. I can attest to that. So I'll be looking for more. Next up, Christmas record. Yeah, it's a Christmas record I picked up just recently and have digitized it and put it on the station for this season. I was just curious about it. When I first saw it, Merry Christmas, Judy Garland. That's something you don't see, a Judy Garland Christmas record. Who's seen that? I do have a CD from Laserlight of hers that I actually love, that I've had for a long time, but like I never thought, saw, knew it was like on vinyl or anything. Christmas was on vinyl from her. But this is Judy Garland and the Mantovani Orchestra. Now, I thought surely Judy Garland and Mantovani did not record together. I don't think they recorded together. So I'm looking at the label and it's Holiday Records, which I'm not, you know, familiar with. And I thought, well, is this any relationship to Mistletoe Records? I am familiar with Mistletoe, which is a budget label that did holiday music. They were a branch of Springboard Records out in New Jersey, which was a budget label very active in the 70s. And this was from 1983, from Audio Fidelity Enterprises, Rahway, New Jersey. I couldn't really find any more information about Holiday Records, but they seem to be, from what I can see from their releases, other releases, is that they are like a budget label, mostly reissues. It looks like most of the stuff they did was reissues of previously recorded holiday music by other artists, that they would do something like this, reissue pieces of it. And I was also, I just wanted to hear it. Like I thought, I really want to hear this because it's, the side one is, as it turns out, Judy Garland. Side two is Mantovani. Side one, I do have Mantovani's Christmas albums, and these are just selections for Mantovani's Christmas albums. However, interestingly, they're edited and edited not very well, so they're much shorter. Some of them end sort of like, that is not the ending, like, but it just ended, like, very odd. And then the first side is Judy Garland. It's Christmas songs, but it's, clearly like at a live recording of some kind. She's performing at, I don't want to say a nightclub because it sounds more like a stage, a larger stage with a bigger audience. But I don't know. I didn't really try to find out what this might have been a recording of originally, where it was recorded, but it's Judy Garland singing some Christmas songs. There's audience applauding. Maybe not the greatest quality recording. Kind of more like a laser light thing.
Have yourself a merry little Christmas. Let your heart be light. Next year all our troubles will be out of sight.
I was glad I picked it up and glad to hear it. I have to keep an eye out for more Holiday Records, a division of Audio Fidelity, Phoenix Entertainment and Talent. I know nothing about them, but seems to be very similar to Mistletoe Records from what I can tell. So Judy Garland, there's a lady I really didn't know much about. I know the name, I know kind of what she did, but I didn't really personally know much about her. I'm talking about Sophie Tucker. Seems like I should have known more about her, right? Don't you think? She was called the last of the red hot mamas. And that's certainly true. I've heard that phrase all my life, last of the red hot mamas. I didn't know it was actually associated with her or anyone in particular, although I guess I should have. Yeah, last of the red hot mamas is Sophie Tucker. So she was, a comedian, a singer, theatrical person, did a lot of radio shows, did shows on stage, very, very long career. In fact, she performed, she was born in 1886. She died in 1966, and she was performing right up until her death at 80 years of age. So quite a stage lady there. She was born in, in the Russian Empire, now it's Ukraine, where she was born. Russian Jewish family, they emigrated to Boston, and they opened a restaurant in Hartford, Connecticut, and she worked in the family restaurant. She also sang in between helping people for tips and made some extra money that way. Yeah, so she goes to, she marries at 17, very young, while she's working at this restaurant. And they elope, have a child. They elope and then they come back and they have a child. But then they have a regular marriage. The family does put on a regular marriage for them. They go to New York. They don't stay married very long. They separate. She's a single mother, basically. And we're talking, late 1800s or something, or around the turn of the century or so. So she's singing in beer gardens and nightclubs and getting by, and she eventually goes back to her family. Things really pick up for her. In 1909, she's part of the Ziegfeld Follies, though interestingly, they eventually let her go not because of her talent, not because of her, people liked her, the audience loved her shtick, sort of being the buxom, sensuous woman belting out these kind of very sensual and funny songs. That was her shtick. They liked it. But I guess, according to what I'm reading, none of the other women would perform on stage with her. Now, I don't really know whether it's because they considered it sort of risque or whether they considered her such a great talent and such a stage stealer that they didn't want to go on stage with her. They just Sophie Tucker, no thank you. I want people to remember me, not her. And they eventually let her go. But because she was very talented, she was picked up, by other people. She did all kinds of things. Again, like I said, very long career, musicals and vaudeville. She did vaudeville for a long time, and she survived the collapse of vaudeville. And went on and worked in Europe. She was popular in Europe and in the States, had recordings that were very popular, always with the same sort of image and the same sort of idea. As it turns out, some of the people I thought of, I was gonna say before I really researched her, that to me, she reminds me of sort of a cross between Mae West and Ethel Merman. But as it turns out, she was, before any of them, she was actually an inspiration to, on record, these people have said that Sophie Tucker was an inspiration to them. And I am talking about Mae West, Carol Channing, Joan Rivers, Ethel Merman, and Bette Midler all referenced Sophie Tucker as being an inspiration to them, and many others.
I say do your exercising in that well-known indoor sport. You've got to be loved to be healthy. That's the easiest way to keep well. If you can't sleep at night and your stomach's not right, or something yellow, then the older they get, the younger they want. They never get too old to fall in love. And as soon as they find silver threads in the gold, they start walking behind every 60.
I don't know that I even call her a singer myself personally. Does she really sing? I mean, to me, she sort of belts, talks through songs in a way, kind of belts them out, kind of talks through them. But I love her stuff. Completely enjoyed this record. Sophie Tucker, yeah, She's pretty cool. Finally today, I actually have two copies of the same record. I don't know how I ended up with two. I must have got them cheap somewhere and just didn't realize that I have the other one, because I don't usually do that. I'm not sure which one was first. This is the 101 Strings, but it is conducted and arranged by a very famous composer-conductor, Nelson Riddle. This would be the release that really emphasizes his name. And this one uses Bridge Over Troubled Water as the title, with Nelson Riddle conducting the 101 Strings. Now, I wish somebody, not me, I don't really have the adequate information, but I would love to see a video or maybe a page or an article or something. I was kind of looking for it, like a really complete history of the 101 Strings, because they are kind of an interesting outfit. There was an orchestra, not by the name of 101 Strings, but it was an orchestra in Germany that was the 101 Strings. I mean, they took their recordings and used that name for several years. Then there were different conglomerations that, but they always would use the name 101 Strings, and they would never say, oh, it's actually this other orchestra, or it's, no, it was always billed as the 101 Strings. It was on All Shire Records, Somerset, blah, 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 kind of budget labels, but good stuff, lots of good stuff. And they went all the way through to somewhere in the 1980s, I think the last of the 101 Strings appeared. Now, this one was recorded in 1970 in London. It is past the time of most of the 101 Strings albums. So, interestingly, even the liner notes kind of tell you, Nelson Riddle says when he was commissioned to do this album by Al Sherman, he gives a lot of the credit to the fine orchestra that was assembled for him by Jack Dorsey in England. So they assembled this orchestra. I don't know if it was probably already somebody's standing orchestra. I don't know. And then he, you know, talks about the arrangements. So there are different, and he thanks the various soloists, because each of the different songs has a tendency to highlight a different instrument. So there's some solo passages here. So at this point there really is no orchestra called 101 Strings, but they're using an orchestra that was assembled by Jack Dorsey, Nelson Riddle. Nelson Riddle, if you don't know, was very well known, lived from 1921 to 1985, composer, arranger, orchestra leader. He did a lot of his own records, but is really well known also for working for Capitol Records as the backing orchestra for many, many big names in the recording field, in the charts, easy listening at that time. He had kind of retired and whatever, you know, after this, a little bit after this, his career was, or somewhat, was revived. Kind of funny, in the early 80s when he was, got a telephone call and was approached by Linda Ronstadt, who wanted to do some albums of old standards, and she wanted to make a deal with him to arrange his orchestra to do the backing for three albums. And he didn't know who she was. He didn't follow popular music at all, and didn't like rock music at all. Didn't follow it. He asked his daughter about her. His daughter knew who Linda Ronstadt was, and she said, well, I don't know if you like her music, but the checks won't bounce. So he agreed to do it, and the rest was history, because that, especially What's New, were quite popular albums, and, you know, did very well, and he won an award for those albums. This one's recorded in London in 1970, and the reason I'm talking about it is because if you love kind of groovy, cool, airport lounge, swinging 70s, late 60s, kind of like We're So Cool, We're the Jet Set, in the lounge getting ready to fly to, you know, Cabo San Lucas or whatever, this is that kind of music. It's a very cool. It's not a traditional, like, easy listening. This is like that sort of groovy airport lounge core sort of Groovalicious. Les Baxter did an album with 101 Strings. He actually, I think, did two. that are very similar to this in the style. Once it hit 1970 or late 60s, some of these arrangers, you know, got kind of groovy. Was one of them, and I loved this record so much, even more than I was expecting to. I'm like, wow, this is a keeper. Like, of the 12 tracks, 9 of them are originals by Nelson Riddle, which I love to find more original tunes instead of just the same songs over and over again, same standards. Great stuff. Costa Brava, very exotic, Latino sentimental, meandering, freeway fantasy, Twilight on the Mall, Nelson's Blues. I mean, they give you an idea. Like, it's a cool record. If you come across this one, nab it. It's a keeper. It's not dreamy, sleepy, which I love, easy listening music. It's that groovy airport lounge kind of stuff. That's it. I hope you enjoyed that today. Long video. Whew, sorry. So long, but I haven't done one in a while. If you enjoyed it, please give it a thumbs up. Comment below if you have any of these records or discussion about any of these artists. I always love to hear more information. I hope you're having a nice holiday season and are keeping warm wherever you are. Thank you for watching, guys, and we'll talk to you in the next video.